cavernous. Put your head down, do your stint. Oil and incense. Zachariah, chosen by lot, all alone in the temple with God. How could he have seen the angel coming with a word brand new to shatter hopelessness forever, shatter hopelessness forever?
Shadow. welcome you all here to the Sterling First United Methodist Church. We're really glad that everybody made it this morning, and welcome those on the live stream as well. Join us today. We have a brunch afterwards, after the service here, for the Christmas brunch. Today's the last day for the Goodfellas Angel Tree outside where all the presents are. If you haven't yet, please drop off your Angel Tree gifts under the tree in the Northex there for Goodfellas to pick up tomorrow. Poinsettias are still available for your Christmas season. If you'd like to purchase a poinsettia in memory or honor of someone, submit the form to the welcome desk and your payment in the offering plate or by the church office by December 15th. Poinsettias are $13. For those who are wanting order but unable to attend in person, please contact the church. We've got some fun-filled church-wide activities to look forward to this Advent season. Join us next Sunday, December 19th, for our Grinch movie party from 4 to 6. Bring your favorite Christmas snacks and some pillows and blankets and get comfy in the Connection Cafe as we will watch and enjoy time of fellowship together. The UMW greeting cards are available at the welcome desk. A pack of five is $15. And remember that the church choir will be rehearsing following the brunch today, and the finance committee will be meeting after also. And if there's, our Christmas Eve service will take place December 24th at 7 right here in the sanctuary. Come and go communion will also be available from 4 to 6 for those who would like to partake. Hope to see you all there. If we can be in prayer for you, please let us know via the church office. We'd love to be praying for you in any way we can. If there are no other announcements, please turn your attention to the worship team as we prepare our hearts for worship. Covenant in whom you delight. Indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. Help is on the way, just as the prophet Malachi promised. Help is on the way through the words of two messengers. First, John the Baptist was born to prepare the way for the work of the Messiah, Jesus Christ, who came to dwell among us to prepare the entire world to be messengers of peace. We are all born for a purpose. We too can use your world to be messengers of peace. We are all born for a purpose. We too can use our voices and our gifts to make a way for others to be near Christ. In this world of noise and chaos, let us always make room for peace as we dwell in the kingdom of God with one another.
Would you stand together as we worship? dust on a rose. Winter comes for us all. Oh, how nature acquaints us with the nature of patience. Like a seed in the snow, I've been buried to grow. For your promise is loyal, from seed to sequoia. And I know, though the winter is long, even richer, the harvest it brings. And though my waiting prolongs, even greater, your promise for me like a seed. I believe that my season will come.
Lord, I think.
Lord, I think of your love like the low winter sun. As I gaze, I am like a fire to the storm, I'm renewed in your warmth. Melt the ice of this wild soul till the barren is beautiful. And I know, though the winter is long, even richer, the harvest it brings. Though my waiting prolongs even greater, your promise for me like a seed, I believe that my season will come. I can see the promise, I can see the future. You're the God of seasons, and I'm just in the winter. If all I know of harvest is that it's worth my patience, then if you're not done working, God, I'm not done waiting. You can see my promise, even in the winter, 'cause you're the God of greatness, even in a manger. For all I know of seasons is that you take your time. You could have saved us in a second. Instead, you sent a child. And I know, though the winter is long, even richer, and the harvest it brings. Though my waiting prolongs even greater, your promise for me like a seed, I believe that my season will come. And when I finally see my tree, still I believe there's a season to come. Like a seed you were sown for the sake of us all. Oh, from Bethlehem soil grew Calvary's sequoia. Oh.
Amen.
Today, we offer the light of peace to illuminate the door of welcome. May this light shine in our hearts, in our lives, and in our church. May peace awaken us to possibilities and lead us to greater hospitality. There is room in this inn, a house for the holy. Would you pray with me? You find us in your lostness and with love beyond your imagining. You lead us home. In the season of longing, grant us grace to bring all that you are to you. O Christ, all the broken places, all the lost wanderings, all the weariness from trying to live lives that are pleasing to you. Hold them to all in the fullness of your love. Then be born in us, that we may find our home, our life, our peace in you.
Lord of light and love.
Let's continue in worship. Sing, Who is Man?
Restore the joy of our
may be seated. And kiddos, come on down for children's time. All right. Hi, guys. How are we doing today? Good. Are we excited to be in church this morning? Yeah. Can you guys smell all of the good stuff happening in the kitchen? I just started smelling it like halfway through that second song and I got real distracted, I'm not gonna lie. It was really good. It smells so good. All right, well, so today we're gonna talk about peace. What do you guys think of when you think of peace? What do you think, Tessa? Calm? Yeah? You're gonna say calm too? What else? Quiet, yeah? Not being harmed. Ooh, I like that, right? So peace can be all of those things. I totally agree with you. And today we're gonna talk about this guy named Zechariah. Can you guys all say Zechariah? Zechariah. And Zechariah was the husband of Elizabeth. Do you guys remember talking about Elizabeth last week? Yeah, maybe? Was she the lady that was with Mary? And there was a baby in her tummy and it leaped for joy when it saw when Mary was there. Do you guys remember that? Yeah? So Zechariah, did you know most of the time when there's a baby that's gonna come, your mom is the one that knows first, right? You would think so, right? But did you know that Zechariah knew that their baby, John, was gonna come before Elizabeth did? Did you guys know that? You did? No, you didn't? So when Zechariah was a priest in the temple, okay, and he was working late one night, and an angel of the Lord came to him and said, "Hey, Zechariah, I got some good news for you. You and your wife, even though you're old and you've been wanting to have a baby for a really long time and you thought it wasn't going to happen, guess what? It's going to happen." What do you think Zechariah did? Yeah, just, what? What? Yeah, he had a really hard time believing it. Even though there's an angel of the Lord standing in front of him, he's like, psh, yeah, right, okay, great. Where's the person behind the curtain? Where's the hidden cameras, right? He's just like, what are you talking about? And the angel is like, that's not the response I wanted. So you know what the angel did? He told Zechariah, "I'm going to make you silent. You're not going to be able to talk until your baby is born." Yeah, just like that, Tessa. But nothing's coming out for 9 months. Do you think you guys could be quiet for 9 months? I don't think you could. I couldn't either. It's okay. Right? But in that time, Zechariah experienced a lot of peace, right? He experienced a lot of calm and a lot of quiet, right? Because he couldn't talk, right? And what he had to do in that time was listen. He had to listen and he had to watch and pay attention to other people. And I bet you, as he saw Elizabeth's tummy getting bigger and bigger as the baby was growing inside of her, he got a lot of peace and a lot of excitement from that time. Do you think? Yeah? And then in the passage that Pastor Amy's going to read to us after John was born, Zechariah is like a totally different person because that peace changed him. Isn't that kind of cool? Yeah? So do you think you can only have peace if it's totally quiet? No? Do you think peace can come through other things? What other thing can peace come through? What do you think? Reading the Bible, that's right. Spending time with God, that's awesome. What else? Ooh, seeing people enjoy something. I think that's true too. Do you think that we can get peace from music? Yeah, some really pretty music. And I think you guys might have a song that might give us some peace. Yeah? So can we sing that together? All right, come on up. Perfect.
Man, what beautiful music to our ears and to our soul. That was just absolutely beautiful. Thank you for all those who worked to make that possible this morning. What a way to celebrate this season of Advent. And Advent means coming or arrival. And the focus of this entire season is the celebration of the birth of Jesus the Christ. His birth, his first advent, his coming to the world of us, which is in a great need. This season also provides us with an intentional opportunity to reflect on the anticipation of the return of Christ in his second advent. Advent is far more than simply just marking a 2,000-year-old event in history. It's about celebrating a truth about God, the revelation of God coming in Christ. It is where all of creation may be reconciled to God because of the tiniest of kings. Last week, as Jordan alluded to, we talked about Mary's visit with Elizabeth. Elizabeth's baby leaped in the womb when it heard Mary's voice. And Elizabeth was delighted to see what God had done in both her life and in Mary's. And Mary responded in worship that her soul, in her soul that glorifies the Lord as she acknowledged that this just isn't all about her. This morning, we're going to take a look at the events that surrounded John's birth. Now, some would ask why we'd look at him at Advent. Well, he was a proclaimer. He was a pathlayer and a room maker. He was the one who brought the words prophetic witness to life. His job was to proclaim the coming of the King. John the Baptist was a forerunner, much like Isaiah, who proclaimed the truth. From his life, we are encouraged that we too can be proclaimers always. But it has to all start somewhere. So this morning, through our scripture, we're going to see where John's story starts. And I'm reading from Luke chapter 1. Verses 57 through 80. Now the time came for Elizabeth to give birth, and she bore a son. Her neighbors and her relatives heard that the Lord had shown his great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her. On the eighth day, when they came to circumcise the child, and they were going to name him Zechariah after his father, but his mother said, "No. He is going to be called John." They said to her, "Well, none of your relatives has that name." And then they began motioning to his father to find out what name he wanted to give him. He asked for a writing tablet, and he wrote, "His name is John." All of them were amazed. Immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue freed, and he began to speak, praising God. Fear came over all their neighbors, and all these things were talked about throughout the entire hill country of Judea. All who heard them pondered them and said, "What then will this child become? For indeed the hand of the Lord was with him." Now, then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he spoke this prophecy. "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that he would be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our ancestors, Abraham, to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all of our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins, by the tender mercy of our God. The dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. The child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly to Israel. We thank God for these wonderful prophetic voices that give us hope and love and joy and peace. On December 9th of 2021, which was just last week, a news station, WFSB of the Great News Reporting Group, ran the following story of a Connecticut woman who shared news of a joyous and devastating day in her life. The day her newborn son was born was also the day his father died. Haley Park shared the story of her son's miracle birth on Facebook, and he was born 3 weeks early by C-section on December 2nd, the same day his father, J.B. Park, died of cancer. The Sunday before, J.B. Park was admitted to the hospital with complications from cancer. While the Parks thought that they had 6 months left together, they found out on Wednesday that it would be just a matter of a few days. And she quotes, or she writes this on her Facebook page, Haley Park does, "With our second son's due date 3 weeks away, my husband and I knew asking for an induction was the right thing to do. Without hesitation, the team of ICU doctors communicated with the high-risk labor and delivery doctors. They offered me an induction as soon as I was ready," wrote Haley Park. "The induction process began, but as of Thursday morning, JB's condition was declining so fast that the medical team worked quickly to deliver the baby born via C-section." Haley goes on to write, in a matter of literally 1 minute, "I was in the OR, and just a short 20 minutes later, our son was born. He was given to me for a quick kiss, and then a team of doctors and nurses ran him up 2 floors, and he was placed on his daddy's chest. Once the baby was placed on the father's chest, his mother wrote that J.B. Park's vitals instantly improved, and he was able to acknowledge their very precious son. JB's last moments were spent with his newborn son and wife in his hospital room. Haley Park says her husband took his last breaths with their son on his chest and her hand in his. From the OR to the ICU room, there were what felt like hundreds of doctors and nurses floating through us this process effortlessly. Not one of them having a dry eye the entire time. Some of them told me that they'll never forget the act of selflessness." Haley goes on to write, too, that some called my actions brave and heroic. "I just call it love. I acted out of love. I put my trust in God that this was all part of his plan. And what I did, I had to do out of love to fulfill my husband's last wish." The couple hadn't picked out a name before their son's birth, but the mother wrote that she knew the right thing to do was to honor her husband. She named the baby John Beeson, J.B. Park. He was born weighing 7 pounds, 4 ounces, and 20 inches long. And his mother says his birth story is truly a miracle. That's a bittersweet story. As a newborn infant took his first breath, his father took his last, making room and giving way to eternal peace. This story, as heartbreaking as it is, it does remind us that even in the darkest points of life, there is still hope. For there is new life and new light breaking even through the darkness. Through the corridors of hospitals everywhere, day and night, babies are born. It is a sign to patients and to staff that there is always hope for transformation and new life. Even in the midst of the darkest struggles of life, even in the same place where birth and death take place, at the same place, at the same time, there is always light, even in the darkest struggles, even in life's most painful moments. After years of barrenness, Elizabeth is surprisingly pregnant. In her old age, she gives birth to a son. This miraculous event evokes both memories of the birth of Isaac in the Old Testament to the patriarch and matriarch of God's people, Abraham and Sarah. It was also a birth promised by God. God is at work in all of history, bringing salvation in the way of rest, rescue, and reassurance to God's people. An angel announces his pregnancy to her husband, Zechariah, proclaiming that this child will be the prophet of the Messiah, the one who will go before the Lord to prepare God's ways. The pregnancy, its announcement, and the baby's birth is a sign to the Judean people that God's power is working to transform the world around them. And this story is still a sign to those who hear it even centuries later, prompting us to ponder the signs of wonder of God's transforming power in yet our very own times. Zechariah's song of praise and blessing is known as the Benedictus. I read it in the scripture earlier. It extols the salvation of God. Although it was originally written in Greek, the song echoes themes of the Hebrew salvation history that are keeping the song's possible origin in a first century Jewish Christian community. Both Mary's song, known as the Magnificat, found in the earlier chapters of Luke, and Zechariah's song come from the mouths of characters who are prophetic signposts pointing out for generations to come what it looks like to have an utter reliance on God. Mary became God's handmaid, willing to serve God with her whole being. And Zechariah, learning through his trial by silence to rely on God's very surprising, unexpected ways. Utterly relying on God, a young, ordinary girl and an old, ordinary priest joyfully proclaimed that God was on the move despite times of personal hardship and uncertainty. No longer would the future be hopeless and barren for all of God's people. They both made room for God to work. In Zechariah's song, his reference to salvation is a personal call for each of us to rely on and to follow God. For he guides our feet into the way of peace. making us each vessels of light to those who sit in darkness and even in the shadow of death, prompting us to each in a personal, to each be personally actively involved in the transformation of God's family, of God's community. I mean, what would happen if in the world, if ordinary people like you and I, if we stood strong in our utter reliance in God and began extending the story of God's work, even in the midst of loss and pain and or in the chaos, the everyday chaos of our lives? What if we were still able to sing out in hope and in joy? What if, as people of faith living on this side of the Christmas story, what if we began to practice complete reliance on God? Not a reliance on the right stock market figures, the right retirement benefits, or on the right governmental policies, or even on the right faith community or perfect worship service, but what about relying on God Himself? God calls us each to be agents of restoration and of peace as we physically, politically, and economically show forth God's justice and His love in all of our relationships with our families, with one another, with society, and His natural world. Zechariah's song reinforces God's historic salvation story to ordinary, faithful, and in many cases, impoverished people. Impoverished of the soul people, just not monetary poor people. But He calls each of us to be a prophetic witness, to share messages of hope, joy, love, and peace, not just during Advent, but throughout our entire lives. Again, through this chapter of the Christmas story, we are reminded that we are all called to be a prophetic witness to and for Christ, regardless of our educational attainment, regardless of our relationship status or our economic successes. And each time a baby is born, each time parents and or grandparents or loved ones cuddle that little one and we look into their eyes and allow their fingers to curl around our hands and to hold those little tiny bundles. Each time that happens, each time a baby is born, the world changes. Each time we see a new baby, we need to believe. We need to see the world more expectantly, and we become filled with dreams. Perhaps we might even ask some of the same questions that was asked of Zechariah's son. You know, the best way to hold the baby is just allow their little head right here and their little bottom right here in your hand. That's just the best feeling ever. And as we hold them, and as we see them, we perhaps ask, and then what will this child become? We begin to make big plans for tiny little ones. The big plans that God has for each of us, it does not necessarily lead to worldly successes. However, His plans do move us toward being to be witnesses of the kingdom that God is breaking into this world. The signs of God's sparing and deliverance from darkness are extraordinary, and ordinary as the birth, as ordinary as the birth is to grateful parents and grandparents and friends and neighbors. The miracle is that God never gives up sending us signs of new hope and new life in this world, because God never, ever gives up on us. The signs of God's rescuing through love and grace are His greatest gifts that He has ever given, and they keep coming again and again. And we just need to make room to receive them. Even though ordinary people, if we are listening, we can still hear surprising songs of God's transforming work, that He cares enough for each one of us to come and to dwell among us. And we must dwell in Him through the way that we live out our lives, through the way that we share stories of how He has worked in our very own lives. He gives us every day opportunities to birth new stories of hope. The redemptive story of God's desire for us is to live in heavenly peace. That song still sings, and it shouts, and it even sometimes whispers prophetically of God's guidance to the way of peace. Now, here's the thing. We all experience sadness at every point in our lives. We all walk through the valleys in the shadows of death. We all walk through those difficult times. And it may sound cliche, and yes, you've probably heard it before, but Christ dwells with us in the darkest of times. Don't just hear it, but receive it and embrace it. Christmas is a time, or Christmas is God's response to the brokenness in this world. But let's think about it. In order to even cast a shadow, is there a scientist in this room that what is something that we need to cast a shadow? What must be present even in a shadow? Light. Even in shadows, even in the darkest shadows or shadows of the darkest valleys, light still exists. The birth of Jesus Christ is God's way of dispelling the darkness and bringing light into this world. We need this Christmas message of hope that moves us to reconciliation and to healing and to peace. In fact, we need Christmas, and we need that light now more than ever. And that is exactly what Zechariah was celebrating. For hundreds of years, the Jewish people had lived in a very dark time, in a very quiet time. Their valley was long, and it was a hard road. And they weren't hearing any of these scriptures that I am sharing with you today. They were on that other side of Advent. They weren't hearing from the other prophets like we are. And in the meantime, as they waited and as they wondered, the Romans, they swept in and began a very oppressive occupational rule of the Israelites. They took over their very own promised land. The Israelites were scared. They were living in unfair, unjust times, and they were experiencing hardship and violence because of their beliefs. But now, just as you've heard from today's scripture, the Israelites, they finally hear a word from Zechariah to comfort them, to bring them peace, to give them a place for their hearts to rest. After hundreds of years of silence, the priest who had been mute for 9 months began to speak a prophecy that a coming Savior will come indeed and deliver his people from the darkness. No wonder he sang out in joy. Over 2,000 years ago, Christ, promised coming, brought joy into the lives of many who were living in fear and in hardship. Today we can rest and be secure in those same promises. Even in the midst of darkness, loss, and our wondering and even our wandering, we can be hopeful and peace-filled too because of what God once did and what he will do again, just as he promised. That is what celebrating Christmas is all about. God's work through Christ continues even now. The delivery of an infant king is God's emphatic declaration that the darkness will be driven out of this world once and for all because the Prince of Peace has come to us. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn on high will break up on us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. As we continue through our Advent journey, we can know that as a newborn takes their first breath, all of humanity can give way to eternal peace. Make room for a miracle to dwell in your hearts. Always make room for the Christ child and for others to come in and to invade our lives. He came to dwell with us. May we dwell in peace and find courage to become prophetic witnesses as we move from the manger out into the world around us together. Lord, make our lives a stable, a house for the holy, a warm and sturdy place for peace to be born, nurtured, and shared. Amen.
Let's continue in worship to our Prince of Peace, the light that is Christ.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
In this moment, we open the doors of our hearts to honestly come before God about what we've done and left undone that created less hope in a hurting world. Let us together breathe out this regret and breathe in the life-giving, forgiving Spirit of God. Let us breathe in the hope that the Christ child brings. And let us breathe out the peace of Christ. Lord, make of my life a stable, a house for the holy, a warm and sturdy place for peace to live and grow. Let us pray together. Compassionate God, in this time of darkness, we wait for the one who will come and will redeem us. As we revel in the merriment of the season and the sparkle of decorations, we remember that there are many of us for whom this holiday season isn't one of joy and of cheer. Father, we pray for those who cannot see the light in the darkness, and we pray that they would find hope, not in the commercial sight of Christmas, but in the promises of the Christ child. Father, we pray for those who grieve this Advent season, fearing the whether it's the first Christmas or the 50th Christmas after losing a loved one. We pray that they would know your comfort and find hope in the promise of the resurrection. Father, we pray for those who struggle to feel joy because they're mired in mounting bills and despair for lack of sufficient employment. We pray that they would have faith that you will provide. Father, we pray for families who are separated by great distances from their loved ones, whose tables will have an empty seat this Christmas. We pray that they would rely on you for strength and for comfort. Father, we pray for those whose family dynamics make holidays not a time of festive joy, but of stress and sometimes anger. Father, I pray that through your grace, hearts can be softened, old hurts can be released, and a door might be opened for reconciliation. Father, on this morning, I pray for those who have been displaced by both the storms of nature and the storms of life. Father, give them shelter. Give them news that they are not isolated, that they are not alone, and send help their way. Father, we lift up our joys and we give our concerns over to you. Father, we lay them all out to you in the name of your Son, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
You'll find it on page 204.
You all are invited to continue the Advent celebration by our Christmas brunch being held immediately, as soon as I'm quiet here, in Fellowship Hall. But I want to go ahead and I want to bless our meal, so you can go ahead and get started with serving yourselves on the buffet, and then I'll send you out with the benediction. So let us pray. Father God, we ask your blessing on this day. We thank you for the food that has been provided for us and the hands that have made it and or carried it in. Father, I ask that you bless our time together. May it be one of good fellowship and sharing together. Let us go now and serve him without fear, to serve God and to one another in order to bring light to those who sit in darkness, even in the shadows of death. Remember, there is always light. Allow God to guide your feet into the way of peace. Amen.